28-10 Aggies. They will receive to start the third quarter. Tulsa won the opening toss, wanted the ball, couldn't do anything with it. Now they'll pay for that, as we'll see the Aggie offense one more time. Randy Simmons this time dropping back deep, along with Wilbert Biggins, awaiting the kick by Eric Lang. And Lang takes full advantage of the wind. Simmons 5 yards deep. And he'll go from the 20. Well, Jeff Granger in that first half, all different types of situations. They had great field position. Sometimes they had to go long, extended drives. But the common denominator, as was the case last week, was he got the job done.
Well, quite a change on the first three to the last three or four when he didn't have as much success.
After that long second quarter breather, Greg Hill back in at tailback and Cliff Gross back in at fullback. And they're not on the same page with Granger here, and Tulsa covers the fumble at the 10-yard line. Chris Bratcher, the nose guard.
And that may be Mr. Granger's first mistake. He turned the wrong way on the pitch. Instead of just taking this ball, see, he turns the wrong way in the pitch. Now he tries to make up for it and throws the ball behind.
That's going to go as a fumble by Greg Hill, but that's misleading. That was Granger all the way, and Bratcher was there. Boy, had this happened early in the first half, what a different game it might be. As it is, Hewley high steps into the end zone. And we may have a game yet. Boy, that's how you want to do it. One play drives, that'll get you back in any game. Lang for the extra point, 28-17.
The last thing you want to do to a team that you have in control is allow them to have life. This gives Tulsa huge life. Nice cut by Hewley, picks out the outside, and watch him just high step it into the end zone. It changes the entire complexion. On the sideline, R.C. Slocum is thinking, let's get this ball, let's drive it down, let's just totally take control of this football game. Now all of a sudden he's in a dogfight.
We've played 10 seconds in the second half, and Chris Hewley has got the Hurricane back within 11 with his second touchdown of the day. They had hoped for a crowd of about 30,000. This stadium seats 40. I don't know if they got 30, but those who are here are making noise. And again, Simmons drops deep with Biggins. It will be Simmons. And he will stagger with a flag down out near the 30-yard line, a 25-yard return for the senior from McKinney.
These flags almost always go against the return team, so it's going to put them in poor field position.
Watch Eric England here against the Tulsa headhunter, James Blake.
Whew. Boy, that's a crunch.
Oh, man. That's the type where, unfortunately, helmet on helmet, you see so many head and neck injuries. That's kind of ugly to watch. Impressive, but ugly. Well, Granger again without the tight field position he had in the first half, and this time they are on the same page. But Hill goes nowhere and might have lost one. Scroggins, the bandit. They'll line him up anywhere.
Yeah, he lines up on what the tendency, what they believe the tendency will be. If it's split backs, he can drop into pass. If it's a power set or eye formation where he knows they're going to run, he'll shade to the strong side. Good guess by him that time.
We want to bring his great quickness into play. He was a running back in junior college. They bulk him up to 252. He dropped Hill for a loss of two. Granger, too low for Harrison. He had him open for first down yardage. Pressure came from the backup bandit, Clint Dishman.
Really important series here for A&M. If they have to punt the ball, if they don't pick up first down, they're going to give the ball back to Tulsa at midfield. You don't want to do that.
Mitchell is right, Harrison is left. And Granger with a straight drop, dropped by Greg Hill out of the backfield.
You see how a crowd is going to be a factor in this football game. They're not out of it now.
Well, barring disaster, they're going to get tremendous field position. Davis has had an awful day. And Chris Penn standing at his 48-yard line. Hurricane playing for the return. This is easily the best kick of the day by Davis, but it's Penn inside the 35-yard line. Reggie Graham with another big special teams hit, but the Hurricane down 11 with all the momentum. And nearly 14 minutes still to go in the third quarter. Tulsa in the first half. The fumble really set the tone for them early. Couldn't get the passing game going. But they've had the time to make the adjustments, and they come out with the passing set. Three wideouts left, and Hewley the lone setback. And Jason Atkinson knifing through for the stop. Atkinson, just a ferocious hitter. Got a start in the Texas game last week. Came up with 10 tackles, subbing for Anthony Williams. That was just a preview of what they expect from him all year.
I can tell you right now what's going on in A&M's huddle. They're saying, listen, we need to take charge of this football game. Need to get our defense out there. Need to make a play, make something happen. Don't give them another score.
Only one on first down for Hewley. They'll try him again, and the same thing happens this time. It's Mark Wheeler from nose guard. So the Aggies, with the quick penetration, force Hewley into the obvious passing situation, third and eight. And they are 3-4-8, picking up third downs.
Now if you're A&M, do you rely on those defensive backs to go man-on-man and try to get pressure on Rubley? Or do you drop back in that zone coverage and try to cover the receivers?
Only 2 of 10 for Rubley. Fair, who has the biggest catch of the day, in motion. Rubley hit as he delivered, and that one intended for a well-covered Brian Thompson. No surprise, Aggies pin their ears back, and they force the incompletion.
I think Hewley actually backed into Rubley that time. But a good stand by the A&M defense. That's what you have to do. You have to take the momentum away from Tulsa in this situation.
Eric Lang didn't sign until June. They thought they'd have Jay Seal back as their kicker. He decided not to return to school, so they quickly got Lang out of Fullerton Community College in California. This from 50 yards, blocked by Frazier. Derek Frazier with the block for Texas A&M.
There's only one way that you block it from the outside, Dave, and that's if the kick takes too long. If your line's not spread enough, there's no way. If they're spread enough, I should say, there's no way you're going to come from the outside. Now, look how far back the kicker is. Takes actually three steps. You see him come in there? That kick just took too long.
Well, I think there's one more factor into play here. Nobody blocked Derek Frazier. Nobody touched him. He almost blocks this waist high.
Here it is again. You see how long it takes? And he comes all the way from the outside.
Well, a flag against A&M. And they might put it on Frazier. He might have been offside. That might be why he got to that ball so quickly. Timeout here in Tulsa.
When you're working out, you want to give it all you've got. General Nutrition Centers features Liquid Power Energy Lift, the fast-acting formula of aminos and natural herbs. Help maximize your tough workout with Liquid Power Energy Lift. GNC, the authority in sports nutrition products.
Every week, feel the excitement, the power of a full impact collision, and college football at its finest. Bear bashers beware. This offense is on the prowl. The Wildcat land attack takes aim. California and Arizona, this is war. This weekend on Prime Network. It's no trick. Have a ball this fall with Prime Network's lineup of October treats. First, college football heats up with exciting action from the SEC, SWC, and Pac-10. And let Bill Parcells and Mike Francesa take you around the NFL. But if football's not your game, hit the pavement at the SCCA Texas World Speedway. Thrills and chills all October long on Prime Network.
Well, the penalty was against Eric Frazier, but not for offsides. The block stands. It was for personal foul after the block. A&M from their 30. Granger audibilizing. And a rare option keeper for Jeff Granger. Might get him 4 yards or so. Big hit by Barry Minter. I don't know that they want to expose Granger on too many options. They say he can run it. He did it some in high school, but obviously that's not where he's going to do most of his damage as a college quarterback.
Actually, he's quite a different specimen from a Bucky Richardson, who looks more like a fullback at 6'2", 225. Granger is more of a just a thin type dropback passer.
Territory. 17 yards before Todd Hayes knocked him out, but hold everything, flag down, Aggies clipped.
And it may be against Granger. Granger threw a block there. It may be a clip against Granger
that
on
that
play.
Might be a first quarterback clipping.
A quarterback clip. Granger over there saying, I didn't hurt him.
Wipe out the 17-yard pickup. You'll see just a flash for the clip here. Right there against Barry Minter.
I don't know how he got around him. It's amazing he was able to still pick up yardage on that play.
Yeah, Biggins had to really take a wider sweep than he wanted to. So it's second and 21 for A&M. Well, play to Hill. Gross with a big block on Minter, and he fights it off and still makes the stop at the 25. Let's pause briefly for station identification. This is the Raycom Network. The 11 minutes in the third quarter from Skelly Stadium in Tulsa. Dave Barnett, Dave Rowe, 28-17. In favor of the Aggies. They led by 18 at halftime. Fumbled on the first play of the third quarter. Tulsa's Chris Hewley took it in. And we just saw a blocked field goal, which could have brought the Hurricane within eight. Granger airs this one out and dropped by a wide open Brian Mitchell. He'll have a long talk with himself now.
That is a ball that you have got to catch. You can see the disgust on Mitchell's face as he walks over there. He knows he should have had it. He was wide open. What a great job Granger did to get around the containment and get the additional time he needed to find his receiver downfield.
On 4th and 29, you saw the numbers for Davis, and Penn should again give the Hurricane tremendous field position. Neutral bounce. Hurricane will have it at their 47, only 27 yards on that kick. And we return after this from Southwest Airlines.
Watching Prime Network, your source for sports.
Oh, and look, little Mark. He's almost 30 now, out in California. What are you looking for?
I wonder where my card is from Billy. He never forgets my birthday.
Oh, you know how busy he is in Dallas these days.
We got 10 minutes.
Oh, it's my grandma's birthday. I didn't send her anything.
Send her a voice card. It's very simple. Yeah, we can do it right here. Dial 1-900-1900.
No way!
No. This is legitimate. It's what 900 numbers should be. Call
1-900-776-5250.
You select from hundreds of messages and famous voices like Bogey or John Wayne, just about anyone. The call's only $1.25 a minute, and it's made automatically on the day and time that you specify. Come on, make your birthday message stand out from everyone else. Call 1-900-776-5250. She'll never know that you forgot.
Billy?
Happy birthday, sweetheart.
Billy,
I thought I'd call.
Billy,
I'd like to wish you a happy birthday.
If I get the card, make the call, sweetheart. 1-900-776-5250.
There's a bar of a bandolero named a Santana riding into Big D to stop the Pony Express. Strap up your chaps, bars and bras. Next weekend on most Prime affiliates.
Well, Tulsa with another great opportunity, a golden opportunity, you're tempted to call it, with 10:26 in the third quarter. Next week, we'll be at Ombi Stadium in Dallas, the Baylor Bears and the SMU Mustangs. That's the best pass defense team in the nation. Not the Bears, the Mustangs. And that is where we're headed next week. Chris Crooms had an extended discussion with referee Tommy Taylor right before huddling up for the Aggies. This has been the Canes' favorite third quarter formation. Three wideouts left, and give it to Hewlett. He's got maybe a Tulsa touchdown. We've got a game. Take time here and discuss whether they should go for two. Is there any question?
I think I'd go for two. What a cut by Hewley. Tremendous cut. They've run this weak side play several times where Hewley starts strong side and then makes the cut back against the line of scrimmage, and he's wide open. Now, once he gets in the field here, he's out running some awfully fast people.
3 yards he goes. That's a great coaching adjustment there. They spread the Aggie defense. They have receivers left. They block right, and that left a gaping hole. That was about a 10-yard wide hole that Hewley sprinted through. Still to go, third quarter. Just moments ago, it seems like it was an 18-point game. The Tulsa scoring drives this half have averaged 6.5 seconds.
And one play?
One play. He's finished both off with touchdowns.
I think they are going to go for two.
I don't know why that would even be worth discussing. R.C. Slocum's been in some games like this, and of his seven losses as a head coach, five have been by six or fewer points. It was Dan Bitson. This is the man who has made one of the most incredible comebacks any athlete, any person has ever made. And he made the cut and rudely overthrew him. This is a guy who in December of 89 was named second team All-American. Caught more than 70 passes, 1,400 yards, and was hit by an unlicensed driver at an estimated 70 miles an hour head-on. The other driver had an epileptic seizure at the wheel. Bitson was not wearing a seatbelt, and maybe the ultimate moral is wear your seatbelt. He had eight potential life-threatening and certainly career-threatening injuries. Compound fracture of his wrist, three ligaments torn in one knee, broken patella in the other, multiple fractures in his thighs, 12 hours of surgery, and then months and months of rehab, and that's where he stands, the all-time Tulsa receiving leadership list. They wondered whether he'd live. Not only is he living, he's playing. Now, he's not what he was, but he's a miracle to be in uniform. Randy Simmons, only to the 11. Billy Cole got him for Tulsa.
Dave, I almost get the feeling like the A&M has slowed down. They were in control of this football game. It's kind of like a race car. You've been out racing all the while, and you got a big lead. So do you ease off or do you continue? A&M has eased off, and now they need to get cranked back up again. And that's hard to do.
This has been two different games. Tone of the first half set by Tulsa's early turnover. Tone of the second half set by the Hill fumble on the bad pitch by Granger. When in doubt, go to GHT. Tracy Scroggins held him to two or three. At the conclusion of today's game, Dave and I will announce the Southwest Airlines player of the game.
Greg Hill for the ball carrier, number 27.
And the injured Aggie is John Ellisor, the right guard, junior out of Kingwood, one of only two returning offensive starters. Really only one, considering Richardson's injury, and Mississippi State even with Tennessee.
Well, that's a big score. You know, Mississippi State had only allowed, that had not allowed a touchdown before this game.
In three games. Well, Ellisor at the 15-yard line getting a long look. 6'3", 275-pounder. He was battling an injured ankle coming into the season anyway, and no telling what this is. We won't speculate, but he'll be replaced by a senior, Greg Lakin, at right guard. Lakin himself coming back from shoulder surgery in the offseason.
Boy, if you're R.C. Slocum and his staff, what you're saying right now is, please, just get a first down. Get us out of this field position.
Bill got three, second and seven. Quick toss for Harrison, deflected at the line. It'll be third down. Keo Coleman with a Bulldog interception return. That tie didn't last long. It's 24-17, Mississippi State. Ellisor back in. He only rested one play. Wanted to put on a show for the homeboys, and he picks off Jeff Granger. Left guard Tyler Harrison prevented a touchdown return. And Tulsa Tulsa goes for the lead. Rubley to Hewley. Inside the five. Boriot with the hit. As we again look at the interception by Minter.
Well, sometimes you can't throw over these 6'3" linebackers, and that's what Granger tries to do. Minter just brings that thing down. He almost scores on this play.
It was Tony Harrison, the intended receiver, Tyler Harrison. If the Aggie defense holds here, may have saved the day. 8:55 in the third, 28-23 Aggies, second and goal. New quarterback, Matheson, end zone. That's the target every quarterback wants in the end zone.
Dave Rader said yesterday he has no speed. He's not a quick man off the line, but at 6'8", basketball player type person, he can go way up for the football.
Going for two again. Rubley back in at quarterback. And with the dive, did he get it?
No.
Missed by inches. But Tulsa with a one-point lead. They were down by 18 points less than 7 minutes of clock time ago.
Well, again, watch the backside pressure on Rubley.
Matheson, they slipped in, and that's an interesting call in itself because Rubley's the throwing quarterback. Matheson is the wishbone quarterback.
Again, you see, watch Wade Casey wave at him. He kind of, well, we can't see it from that picture, but he waved at him. I'm wide open. Throw it in here.
His third year of football after 2 years of basketball, the pros are interested in him, and you just saw why.
Once again, Buick is raising the banner for quality in America. Introducing the 1992 LeSabre. With a higher level of power, safety, security, and convenience. This new LeSabre is going to be one tough act to follow. LeSabre for 1992 from Buick.
Every Wednesday night, Prime Network brings the great outdoors to your living room. From the how-tos of fishing to the nation's most scenic locales, professional outdoorsmen guide you on your journey across the country. From lady anglers landing lunkers to the latest news on hunting, fishing, and conservation. Wednesday nights, leave the city lights behind and escape with Prime Network on your wildest adventure ever.
It's showtime. Showtime. Hey! Whoa!
Outdrive your partner with this half-hour instructional video, free with a 1-year subscription to Golf Digest, just $19.77. Call 800-453-4300. Imagine the video and Golf Digest. Call 800-453-4300.
Say, yeah, we expected this. No, they didn't.
Nobody expected this.
28-10 at halftime, 8:44 in the third quarter, and it's 29-28 Tulsa. Biggins deep touchback. And again, the Aggies will start 80 yards away. This is just remarkable.
Yeah, this has been the longest third period that R.C. Slocum's had in a long while.
And it's not halfway done. But Rader said, if we can, first of all, create our own breaks. Second of all, see how these young Aggies react to adversity. That's how we have a chance to win this game. And this third scoring drive of the third quarter, only two plays. The first two drives took one play. Aggie turnovers have made them their own worst enemy. Greg Hill stopped maybe for a half-yard gain by Bratcher, the nose guard.
Right now, it's regroup time for A&M. They need to get back what they did so well in that first period when they just dominated this football game.
19 points in less than 2.5 minutes. And you don't do that without some help.
You don't do that against the great A&M defense either.
They have found an answer for Mr. Hill. We haven't had much GHT time since that first quarter. Granger with another great fake. And another drop by the Aggies. That was short the tight end who had first down yardage but couldn't gather it in. Granger did his job perfectly.
He certainly did. He threw that ball in there. Sharp should have had that catch on the sideline. I think he was too concerned with trying to keep his feet in and took his eyes off the ball.
After his great start, two touchdowns among his first three completions, he's missed his last six passes. And they've got some drops mixed in there, but he is 0 for his last six.
Starts to pull up here. They turn him back inside, and then there's pressure right up the middle. Now he gets out of this one, and as you said, he just threw this thing as far as he could, just avoid a huge sack. Boy, I'll tell you, again, the punter punting into that wind. Tulsa, they're standing almost midfield to receive this ball. They're going to get great field position another time.
Davis with maybe his best effort of the day. Fair caught by Penn, but Tulsa will only be 55 yards away. That one only 33 yards, but it's the best effort by David Davis today into that win. All right, now it's really a hurricane warning.
It certainly is, and if you're R.C. Slocum, you're saying, defense, we need a big play. We need a turnover. We need to stop them here. We need to get better field position. If you're Dave Rader, you're saying, offense, just keep it alive, keep the drive, make positive yardage on each play, and pick up first down, and then possibly a score.
Last time with this same formation, really went 63 yards for a touchdown. This time he goes 1 yard. Buckley and Henry for the Aggies. Those of you with us along the Prime Network and its nationwide family of regional sports cable networks, glad to have you with us for what's turned into an amazing comeback by Tulsa. Down 18 at the half, 19 points in less than 2.5 minutes here in the third quarter, with still 7:15 to play, and they lead it 29-28. Play action, Rubley with a great fake this time. Aggies had kept him out of the game until that touchdown pass. Now two big receptions.
Boy, and he took a shot on that ball. To be able to pull that ball in on this play, this is fake, come bootleg out, and pick up Wade Casey coming across. But watch the big hit on Wade Casey, but he doesn't let go of it. High, there's Bates, bam! And he holds on.
First and 10, Aggie, 39. Paying a little closer attention to Hewley.
You know, if I was to say to you, my quarterback's just, he's gone 2 of 11 for 32 yards. Would you think you scored 29 points? Prior to that pass, that's what Rubley's record was. 2 of 11 for 32 yards.
That's got to be as well as any team has ever held him in check. But it's just not going to last for 60 minutes. He's too good. action. And with the great stretching grab this time. Marlon Haynes had it pretty well covered. And Rubley, who's been victimized by some drops, got bailed out on this grab by Penn.
Well, one of the things that Dave Rader told us in our pregame talks was we were so close last week. On the fingertips, just another inch here and there, a big catch, and the game would have been different. Today, they're making those catches.
They still need five. Third down. New play. Play clock at two. As he goes alley-oop, this is Thompson way behind him. And now, do you go for it on fourth and five? Why not?
The only thing that you can think of in this situation for not going is to pin A&M back inside the 20-yard line again with that wind in their face.
They have averaged getting the ball at the Aggie 34-yard line here in the third quarter. Well, rather than go for it, they send Lang in. Now, last time he was going to try a 50-yarder, and Derek Frazier blocked it. Frazier this time lines up on the right side of the defensive line and again gets there, and he might have gotten a hand on it again.
I think it takes Lang too long to kick the ball because it's just so hard to come all the way to the outside around there, and I think he got another hand on it. Now, one thing that may help him is that the end has been blocking down so it shortens the distance. But I just think he takes too long to kick the ball. Watch this. Around the outside, if the end blocks down, see him stretch out there? I believe he touched the ball. Looking at the trajectory of the ball, it didn't spin like it had been. There you see.
Well, you know, even if Frazier doesn't touch it, he still should get credit for it because his presence was felt. Hill juking just to get one. That Aggie offensive line, which was so incredibly good last week, all of a sudden is neutralized here in the third quarter. Todd Hayes made the tackle from strong side linebacker. He wanted, by the way, to give a get-well wish to his grandfather, Dennis Hayes, in Del Rio, Texas, where Todd went to high school before Cisco Junior College. And we send that along to Dennis Hayes. Second and nine. Ranger with a flag down. And caught at the 42. That's Harrison after two great escapes by Jeff Granger for 22 yards.
Now the flag is about almost 8 to 9 yards off the line of scrimmage. If it's going to be a holding call against A&M, it's going to be a 19-yard penalty.
That's what it is.
This year, of course, the change is we see the holding call. The change being that the penalty is marked off from the point of infraction.
Well, Joe Dan McAdams had two shots at Granger that time as Tennessee comes back with a field goal. Granger got away both times, but now we know why with the help of the hold. This mark off puts A&M back at their 20. Watch Ellisor here working on 68 Phil Holmes. As Granger buys time.
Ellisor is 51 now.
Holmes trying to spin away, couldn't do it. Well played. Granger, quick toss to Hill. One tackle. And it'll be third and a makeable three or four. Hill goes 21 all on his own before Willie Hill brought him down.
That may be the biggest play of this third quarter for A&M. They needed something to happen positive. And he, as you say, makes it all on his own. It's just a little dump pass underneath. And watch, he bumps into one of his linemen. He just makes this all on his own.
That play was big, but this one might be bigger. Third and three.
It's like an audible at the line.
tell you, for a crowd that is well below capacity, they're affecting this game.
Yeah, there was a poor communication between Granger and his wideouts. He was trying to call an audible, but just didn't have the time to do it.
So 3 minutes, 34 seconds in the third period. Bob Toledo, the Aggie offensive coordinator, flipping through the metal playlist before making his decision with Granger. Well, if you can put pressure on a young player as talented even as Jeff Granger is, then you get a chance to really see what he's got.
Well, it's a great learning experience for Granger. He's going to be in these situations. Every game is not going to be as easy as last week and, of course, the first part of this game. He may be proving that he's human just like everybody else that plays this game.
Only one of eight this half. Now that will compare to 9 of 13 for 185 yards and 3 touchdowns in the first half. Two tight ends, Matthews and Short. Bill again gets an extra step and uses it to dive for the first down at the 45. That's about as deep as you're ever going to see a tailback line up.
Well, why you give the ball that deep is so that he has vision, and he made Michael White miss him. Michael White jumped in there, and he slashed inside of him and picked up that first down yardage.
Greg Hill today, nearing 100 again. In the national rushing rankings, the only guy trail is that backup for San Diego State, who's a backup again after nearly 400 yards last week. Nice job, but sorry, you're not starting this week. And then you had Hill at 212. Good cut back into the middle. Paul Knotts, the backup strong safety, wrestling Hill along with Hayes, and the clock under 3 minutes in the third. That puts him over 100, 18 carries for 104.
And now A&M is starting to run that offensive line like they should. Now watch him take White out of the play. Good block there by the tight end to take him out of the play. And again, Hill busting up in there. They run so well behind Alex and Ellisor.
Rodney Thomas into the game. He's the setback, and they split Hill along with Harrison wide right. Well, Thomas, just a bulldozer. That's a strong 195-pounder.
And again, right behind Keith Alex and John Ellisor, that combination seems to really be working for A&M.
Well, two sophomores on the left side, sophomore center, junior, senior right side. Is it any wonder that's where they run behind? This guy lost in the shuffle after a mere 7 yards per carry in his collegiate debut last week. Hill out. Extra tight end Matthews in.
And I get the feeling that A&M has regained that composure that they had in the first part of this football game.
There's Thomas out of a shoulder tackle, but ran out of room at the 35. Hayes was there again. This is right what the Aggies wanted.
Yeah.
Nice extended drive, catch their breath physically and mentally. Trailing 29-28.
This is Thomas. He makes the decision to go outside. Once he gets control of the ball, he makes the decision to go outside. And as you said, the sideline's the only thing that stopped him. If he could have gathered himself right there, he may have picked up 6 or 7 more yards.
Thomas again, short side. Barry Minter, who had the big interception, brings him down, but not after another first down pickup.
Well, if my memory serves me right, I think that's 4 or 5 times straight they've run to the right side behind Alex and Ellisor.
So a breather for Rodney Thomas, and Hill back in. A lot of Tulsa recruits on this team from the Dallas area who played against Greg Hill in high school. They really wanted a shot at him before television cameras. Michael White among them, but he's been held in check. Granger on the quickie to Harrison, away from Willie Hill, and in for the Aggie touchdown.
Reggie McNeil,
Well, when Harrison caught that ball, the cornerback looked like he had his feet in cement. Just looked like he was planted in there.
That's his second touchdown of the day. So the Aggies now up 5, and no question that they will go for 2 with Thomas and Hill, both in the backfield. And Mitchell wide right with 2 tight ends.
Boy, when Granger comes here, he's looking this side. Now watch when he squares back. Bam! There's Minter on that weak side blitz, untouched. Now watch the way Harrison makes the cornerback freeze his feet. When he catches the ball right here, the cornerback doesn't know if he's going in or out. See, and he just kind of just turns his ankles. His feet are just locked in there.
Well, number one is Willie Hill, yep, who's the backup for Ford. Ford, their best cover guy, not in. Harrison Burns the backup, and the Aggies go back up, but by only 5, thanks to Minter's tackle.
But what a great gathering of their composure on that drive. They went to what they did best, that off-tackle play behind, we talked about Alex and Ellisor. They drove the ball down, used some time, and as you said, took a nice breath of fresh air to get back in this football game.
Man continues to be James Glenn rather than Venituli. It's a little bit stronger leg for Glenn. Hewley and Dunston Anderson. 1:33 in the third quarter. And it is Anderson from the 13. Got the handle barely. And a return of about 12. Hurricane now down 34-29 after the Aggies scoring drive of 8 plays in 3 minutes and 40 seconds. But the 2 key plays were short passes where first Hill for the starter of the drive, the swing pass that took him from like 2nd and 19 to 3rd and 3. That was the first key play. He did it on his own. And the touchdown, Harrison, he pretty much did it on his own there. Just athletic ability, as much as anything else by Hill and Harrison to get the Aggies the lead again. Hewley met head-on Mark Wheeler. Both he and Pat Henry very effective at nose guard.
There's Bob Davey. He is the defensive coach. And I know he's had some real concern to get that field position all against them the entire third quarter. There's the call.
Are there any teams that don't signal in from the sidelines?
No, very few teams don't signal in. The reason being is that you have coaches up in the box and they are looking for tendencies on the offense, so you signal in the defenses.
Play clock was at 3 when Tulsa called time. And that leaves them with only one more timeout. They used the first one before deciding for the 2-point conversion. And they use this one just to avoid a 2nd and 13. As it is, they discuss 2nd and 8, 46 seconds in the third.
When Dave Rader has to be excited about this football game, I don't think at the end of that first quarter he expected to be in this football game. He said, if we can hang around, we'll have a chance to win it. We'll be all right. And they have hung around.
Trailed by 7, Notre Dame stretching it out over Michigan State, third quarter. And here we're third quarter, 46 seconds, 34-29 A&M. Their 18-point lead vanished in a matter of 2.5 minutes. From Skelly Stadium in Tulsa, Dave Barnett and Dave Rowe. Elsewhere on the Southwest Conference schedule, we've got Tech and Wyoming already underway. Tech pretty good against non-Southwest Conference schools the last 5 years. The nation's top 2 passing offenses, Houston and Illinois. John Jenkins says, I've got something new to unveil, although it won't be the power, I won't be the wishbone, won't be that outlandish, but it'll be new. Arkansas at home again. Texas and Auburn tonight. Quickly drops it off for 10. Chris Penn in Aggie territory and a flag down. 25-yard pickup if it stands. Frazier on the tackle.
You would almost have thought that Rubley was in defensive huddle because he knew blitz right away. It was the perfect call. And he dumped it to the back on that swing underneath. He picks up those big blockers.
Chris coming back.
Sure is.
Well, our producer David Handler, director Johnny Tyus must have been in the huddle as well.
Well, let's see if in fact we can see that clip. Here's the play underneath. Swing pass. Now you get behind those big blockers. Now you start picking them up downfield. There's the push.
Frazier, the guy that got clipped, and he makes the tackle.
Did you see the push right in the middle of the back? Let's take another look at it. Watch the push in the middle of the back here.
And that's Marlo Fair, who is not having a day. He had the two big drops in the first half, and he wipes out the big gainer to Penn here. Aggies have shut out Brian Thompson, the second leading receiver with this Tulsa offense. It's been Penn and Wade Casey here in the second half, and Hewley spins for maybe one. Marcus Buckley hit him on probably the final play of the third quarter. But the Hurricane doing what they had to do. Quick hitters taking advantage of breaks back in the game. And after briefly leading by one, they trail by five as we head to the fourth quarter here in Tulsa.
If there's a goal most everyone's got, it's owning a home. Except, you shouldn't have to jump through hoops to get there. At least we don't think so at Commercial Bank. So before you step up and take a swing at financing or refinancing a home, make the call. The call to Oklahoma's home team. Commercial Bank and Trust. With competitive interest rates and personal service to make your goal. Go for it.
Start the fourth quarter. A&M, which once led by 18, leads by five. Dave Barnett, Dave Rowe, Skelly Stadium in Tulsa. And our first real feeling of football weather today. We've got a great one. Very cool, breezy. Mark Matheson, the wishbone quarterback, in. And Fair out of one tackle, but still probably losing two as Crooms and Buckley close on him near the sideline. Through three periods, here's how the numbers look. And remember how one-sided it was at halftime. Tulsa with virtually all those passing yards coming in the third quarter. And they've come within 99 in total yards. But the big number is turnovers, the Aggie turnovers, the fumbled pitch from Granger to Hill, and the interception by Mender, what got the Golden Hurricane in this game. Early lead for Illinois on the Cougars. As on fourth and one, Fitz goes off the side of Ferrat's foot. This is going to be negative yardage. The official over there scrambling to get out of the way of that howitzer, and it goes for zero.
I don't think he punted to the line of scrimmage. Oh. Well, I thought the referee was trying to find the ball, looking up for it, and fell down.
Now watch this.
Maybe we see it in the left part of your screen here. There's the punt. Now watch the official in the screen here.
Incoming.
There he is. Over to the left. Watch out. Look, it's way up there.
Well, the Aggies with their best field position of the half the middle to Greg Hill. Well, both kicking games leaving something to be desired today.
Boy, that is almost as bad as a turnover. I mean, you might as well go for it on fourth down as to punt it to the line of scrimmage. That is a huge error.
You know, Farratt was one of their best weapons last week, carried for 24 on a fake. And this week, back down to earth. We need eight on second down. And flags. I think it might have been Ellisor, the right guard, moving.
Right now, it's 23 to 137, three TDs.
So second and 13, and that changes your complexion.
Boy, nothing will make a coach's stomach grind more than when you make a mental mistake like that. R.C. Slocum does not like mental mistakes.
Well, he's got the best start ever by an Aggie coach, 18-7-1. Beat his former colleague, Terry Holman, last week. Locked up here in a great one, 34-29 A&M. 13 and a half minutes to play. Again, nothing fancy. Hill will set up third and 10, tackled by Barry Mitter. And at Knoxville, the Jackie Sherrill era sees its first defeat. Tennessee, after trailing 24-17, but they get the last 9 points of the game, and Johnny Majors with a win over his former assistant, Jackie Sherrill. No fullback. They pull Gross. They go wide right with three receivers, and the lone setback, Hill. Granger behind Biggins and picked off again. With another Tulsa takeaway.
One thing they teach in practice is once that ball is up in the air, everybody react to it. And that's what happens on this play. The ball is tipped in the air, and there's usually a call like fire, and everybody turns and looks for the ball and reacts to the ball. On this play, it pays off for Tulsa. There's the tip fire, and you can see everybody reacting back to the football.
And again, just not a well-thrown pass. Too hard, too far behind Wilbert Biggins. All three A&M turnovers here in the second half, and they've given Tulsa new life. We return after this from Southwest Airlines.
When sports scream, when arms are sore, when legs ache, when muscles hurt, why Sports Cream? Massaging Sports Cream In brings fast pain relief. No medicine-y smell, no odor. Why Sports Cream? Because it works.
Athlete's foot. Every year, over 28 million Americans get it. Try NP27. Its doctor-recommended ingredient stops burning and itching fast. NP27. Nothing's a better cure for athlete's foot. Straightforward.
He's been the focal point of your offense for 6 or 7 years. It's devastation.
Controversial.
Week one, how do you fire an offense coordinator after week one?
Unpredictable.
How about Ray Shard here?
Well, you know, to each his own.
Bill Parcells, Mike Francesa. Complete analysis and insights into each week's pro football matchups. Around the NFL.
Every week on Prime Network.
In tennis, you don't just play the opponent. You've got to play the ball. It's how you play the ball that determines whether your shot is in or out, whether the point is won or lost. Now, you can play the ball and win with this half-hour video by Tennis Magazine instruction editor Vic Braden. Free with a one-year subscription. 12 issues of Tennis Magazine. Call 800-228-1200 for a full year of Tennis Magazine, plus the free video. Just $13.77. Call 800-228-1200 now.
From their 33, after the Blake interception. This will make you seasick watching all these momentum shifts.
It really does.
Van Hatfield and Clemson staying perfect. Rubley gives to Hewley, and again he's got wide open spaces. Ridden down at the 35 by Patrick Bates.
I'll tell you what made this play go is that Crooms just did a sellout inside and didn't turn it back inside. He just did a sellout. He went into the block, and Hewley just stepped out around the outside of him. You may see Crooms, number six. He's just going to sell right there. You see, there he is in the picture. Now watch. Once Hewley is outside, he's on a 31-yard run. No containment.
32 yards. Well, Hill's had a nice day. Hewley's had a tremendous day. 168 yards. Ron Jackson, the usual starter, in and fumbles with Flagstaff. The Aggies have it if the play stands. Boy, they rush Hewley after his 31-yard gain. They get Jackson in. They might have coughed up the ball.
Turnovers are going to be a nightmare for Dave Rader.
No indication on the penalty, but definitely an Aggie recovery.
Well, to have a run, to set it up, you're in four down position where you're going to be able to run four downs to possibly pick up a first, and he just loses control of the ball. There's the ball bouncing out. You can see A&M very alertly jumping on top of it, but what a huge turnover.
That's Derek Frazier, who blocked the field goal, influenced, if not blocked, the second field goal. We think he blocked both of them and gets a fumble recovery here. And another momentum change.
RC said that he calls those take it to the house plays. That's when you do something really great and can take it to the house.
What must Dave Rader's inside feel like right now? Up and down. They thought they had a chance to go back up. Now they're back on the defensive, and Greg Hill, who has averaged on his last 11 carries less than 4 yards, again kept in check here. Hickey, the free safety on the stop. What are they doing differently?
Well, a lot of things are going differently for A&M. They're trying to get back into that offensive philosophy where you just power off the ball. Tulsa's still making those quick stunts in the line. They're still getting good penetration. But right now, what I'd do is I'd go back to GHT. Just let him carry the football.
They heard you. But he does not have a first down. It will be third and about one.
This is where you start thinking about going to Gross on this short yardage.
Well, he carried 30 times last week, but usually he wasn't hit until he was 5-10 yards into the LSU defense. He's well on his way to a 30-carry game today. Never shows any signs of wear and tear, though. Two tight ends, short the man in motion, fumble, Granger barely hanging on at the 34, but end of possession. Hill covered it. Tulsa twice had a shot at that ball.
Well, that was an alert play by Greg Hill. He was the pitch man on that play. And you can see Bob Toledo just take off that headset. Now, see, he's the pitch man. Good reaction back to get a coverage on the football. Heads up play.
Near miss by Todd Hayes. Close, but not quite for the recovery. And it is 20. Davis with the wind, almost blocked. And a nice special team shot by Crooms. Easily the best punt of the day for Davis. 44 yards. Penn upset after only a 7-yard return. 10 minutes, 8 seconds to play. And you get the feeling the whole rest of the way, it's going to be one after another after another for the Texas A&M defense. They're going to have onslaught after onslaught from T.J. Rubley and company. A lot of time left.
Prime Network presents today's top 20. Available on most Prime affiliates.
Look closely. This amazing dental breakthrough can clean your teeth better than you've ever cleaned them before. Introducing Power Plaque 2000. It reaches deep down where plaque builds up and scours it away with bristles counter-rotating thousands of times per minute. Why risk all this? Power Plaque 2000 is recommended for everyone. It comes with an extra brush and convenient stand, all for the incredible low price of only $19.95. But wait, order now and get the complete Dazzle Tooth Whitener absolutely free. Just use this proven three-step process for a dazzling smile. Free. It's the perfect combination for the giveaway price of only $19.95. Call now.
Call 1-800-733-8300 or send check or money order for $19.95 plus $4 shipping and handling to Power Plaque 2000, 4500 American Way, Roanoke, Virginia.
Hey fans, Big 8 Bob back with another Big 8 barn burner. This time a Big 10 rival invades Big 8 country. Big mistake. Minnesota battles Colorado. This weekend on Prime Network. Available on most Prime affiliates.
Ron Jackson fumbled on his only carry of the day. He's out. Hewley back in. Rubley. Going for Penn, knocked away by Chris Crooms. The Aggie secondary today has held Rubley. Keep in mind, the all-time Tulsa career passing leader, holder of 7 career school records, to 5 of 16, 72 yards.
They play the best man-on-man coverage, just like Crooms did on that play that I've seen in a long time.
Still 7-0 in Illinois, surprisingly low scoring first quarter between the top 2 passing teams in the nation. 2nd and 10. And Hewley met immediately by Steve Soleri. Marcus Buckley's back up at outside linebacker, the Purdue transfer. Here's a surprise. Florida, with 3 teams among the top 5, the last time a state had 3 teams ranked that highly, it was the state of Texas early in 1977. 14 years ago. This year, Florida State, Miami, and Florida all up there. Rubley for Thompson, picked off. There it is, Kevin Smith, and the pitch back to Patrick Bates. Thompson will drag him down, but there you have it. We've got a new Southwest Conference career interception leader, and his name is Kevin Smith.
What'd he say? Sometimes I make them think that they're open to entice a quarterback to try and throw in my area. He did it that time, too.
Let's look at it. This breaks the tie with SMU's Russell Carter and TCU's Ronald Fraley.
Sometimes I entice them. There it is. I enticed them. Boom. Now watch the little lateral here. This is a nice play. Give it to Crooms.
Yeah, that's slick.
Bates, excuse me.
Well, very badly underthrown by Rubley. Second straight Tulsa turnover. Battling for 2, maybe 3 tough yards, Rodney Thomas. Turnabout fair play. Last week, Bates got the interception. He lateraled to Smith. Nice of Smith to be so fair-minded about it.
Fair play. Well, now it's grinded out time. You got almost 9 minutes left. What you want to do in this situation, if you're Texas A&M, is grind it down, use a lot of clock, get those first downs, don't make a mistake.
Like that. Whole different story this half for Jeff Granger after a near-perfect first half. We pause briefly for station identification. This is the Raycom Network. .842 to go in Tulsa. Dave Barnett and Dave Rowe, 34-29 A&M. They led 28-10 at the half. That all turned around in the span of 2:26 of the third quarter when the Hurricane put together 19 unanswered points to take a one-point lead. Aggies back up and driving after the Kevin Smith record-setting interception. Granger again, a great fake for Tony Harrison, in and out. It'll be third and 14. He has been victimized by too many drops in the second half.
That's a perfect pass on a crossing pattern. Harrison's wide open on the play.
A Roman Anderson field goal and the Cougars on the board. If you're wondering, by the way, R.C. Slocum, no doubt aware of this, Smith needs 10 more interceptions, and it's possible for him. Not for most people, but for him. To tie the all-time NCAA career record, that's 29. Short pass, almost a one-handed grab by the tight end short, but again, Granger not nearly on target that time, being pressured by Tracy Scroggins. And the Kane defense holds. Well, as we said, it's going to be one wave after another. Tulsa pressuring the young A&M defense with a chance every time they get the ball to go back on top. Bennett is 10 after that 44-yarder by Davis last time, his best of the day. For the corner, too much, touchback. .805 remaining. And Tulsa will be 80 yards away from a go-ahead score when we come back.
Listen, listen carefully. This man is using an amazing electronic breakthrough that lets him hear a pin drop across the room. It's the Whisper 2000. Gives you the astonishing experience of super hearing. No more embarrassing complaints when you watch TV.
Honey, please, can you turn that down? I can't even think.
Look, adjust the volume for your personal listening. With Whisper 2000, you don't have to turn up the volume or ask anyone to repeat themselves. It's hard to hear in the back seat of the car.
I can't hear from back here.
Now sit back, tune in, and talk comfortably.
Can you hear me back there?
Loud and clear.
Use Whisper 2000 in theaters and meetings.
What do you say? Brenda,
I love you. Fire up there.
You'll hear every word clearly, comfortably, no matter where you're sitting. Disguised as a pocket-type radio, this latest breakthrough in sound amplification allows you to clearly hear anything you choose.
So good looking.
Similar high-tech devices sell in fine catalogs for $60 and more, but it's yours on this special TV offer for just $19.95. Order the Whisper 2000 now. Discover for yourself the thrilling experience of super hearing. Have your credit card ready. Here's how to order.
To order, have your credit card ready and call toll-free 1-800-733-9800 or send check or money order for $19.95 plus $4 shipping and handling to Whisper 2000, 4500 American Way, Roanoke, Virginia. But for fastest delivery, use your credit card and call toll-free 1-800-733-9800.
Aggies still holding on to the five-point lead. They've come up with a couple of takeaways on the last two Tulsa possessions.
And they need to hold them here. If they can hold them here without a first down, then they get good field position. But that's going to be tough to do against Mr. Ridley and company.
Hewley. Great cutback. A&M field position at the 28-yard line of the Aggies. He goes 52 this time.
Today. Then he uses that great speed downfield, picks up a couple blocks, and he has just topped 220 yards rushing.
That's his second 50-plus yard carry today. He scored from 53 yards out. That takes him to 220 for the afternoon. Rubley will keep and be buried by Otis Mealy. along with Buckley and Coria. That's three of the four Aggie linebackers. The Tulsa individual record for one game, by the way, 312, Mark Bruce against New Mexico State just last year. So he's got a ways to go there.
If I'm Dave Rader, I've got to have flashbacks of the last time we were at the 30-yard line when they fumbled the ball. A great field position and fumbled. And I know he's thinking, don't let that happen again to us.
Which
flashbacks.
If former Aggie Lester Hayes were down there, he'd be lending Fair some of his stick-up because he needs it.
Oh, boy. If you're Dave Rader, you've got to have a knot in your stomach as big as a basketball. Look where they're going to have the ball. Just a crossing pattern. Perfect pass. He catches it. He's just running downfield. They just strip the ball out, recover it, and they've got the ball back.
Back and forth we go. And with 7:05 to play, A&M still by five.
Ever since.
Straightforward.
He's been the focal point of your offense.
By Marlo Fair.
Watch Kevin Smith's right arm when he carries from behind. He just kind of swats around right there, left arm, excuse me, and just knocks the ball down from behind. What a huge play.
Neely recovered. Aggies breathe a little easier. Ground caused the fumble. It did, and it's still Aggie ball.
Dave, the official on the side made the call that he was down. His knee was down on the turf.
Boy, and Dave Rader's offense was halfway onto the field. They were ready for more.
Watch his knee right there. He's down. Now the ball's still there. Now you'll see the ball pop out.
I don't think the ground caused it necessarily. Lewis Curtis caused it, but the knee was down.
Yeah, he slips when he makes his cut here and goes down. There's his knee down. Right there he was down. And the ball's still in his possession.
Good call. Timeout, Granger. Play clock was down to nothing, and I don't know if he got... I guess he did get the timeout just in time. So we'll take it with him with 6:28 remaining. As Bob Toledo and Granger discuss the options, it'll be 2nd and 8 for the Aggies when we return.
Contrast. The professors at the University of Tulsa are a study in contrast. They all enjoy teaching as much as you enjoy learning. However, some might pull, tug, or coax you, while others push, stir, and nudge. A professor can be your mentor, your inspiration, your encouragement, your tennis partner, or your friend.
Just don't go into the classroom and teach the classes and then leave and never see the students.
You get to know students, they get to know you. The barriers break down. They start saying things they didn't know they were able to say.
My task as a teacher is to get students to face the realities of life as seriously as possible.
I'm learning from them. I value the bright minds that I get to the privilege of interacting with.
I think the type of student that would do well here would be the type of student that prefers a smaller academic environment, who wants to be sure that they're counted, that they're noticed.
The University of Tulsa.
Well, that's as it is known today, 11th Street here in Tulsa. But in your day...
Route 66,
that's,
buddy.
That's the Route 66.
I used to watch that program when I was a kid. Route 66.
Getting some kicks today with 6:28 to play. Aggies on 2nd and 8. Granger play action. In and out of short's hands. He had his choice of tight ends. McKeon was open short. Short was open a little deeper. That would have been a first down grab. Instead, 3rd and 8. And both quarterbacks victimized by drops all day.
They've had drops all day long. If I'd been Granger that time, I think I would have thrown to the underneath man. He was so wide open, he had no coverage on him.
At the 39.
Boy, that was a nice catch. Going out of bounds, diving out for it, had to reach away from his body, and a perfect throw on the out pattern. This is the out pattern.
And for a team that lost their top four receivers from last year, they needed to develop a go-to guy, and it looks like they've done that. The sophomore from Houston, Forrest Brooks, seventh catch today. Dylan Thomas in the all-freshman backfield. Greg Hill for about four. More pressure on the Aggie ground game this half because Granger threw the air since halftime is though now with that completion to Harrison, 3 of 14 with two interceptions.
Well, you remember when R.C. Slocum played last week, Lean on Me? This week he's going to be playing some type of an educational song because this has been a real learning experience for these young Aggies.
Hang on, Sloopy, there.
Hang on, Sloopy is right.
Maybe not. Second and six. Head-on crash at the 45-yard line as Phil Holmes was there to bury Hill, and it'll be third and four as Michael White helps out on his 12th tackle. He wanted this game. He's the Dallas Kingston product. Wanted to go head-to-head with all his former high school rivals for this Texas A&M team.
We had 119 tackles last year.
They pulled Gross, Hill the lone setback, Biggins the extra receiver on the inside. It'll be Hill. Play, of course, was the interception in the third quarter. This one's close because with 4:20 and counting, Tulsa's got to get it back. Down five. David Davis improving that average. It's 10 at the 14. And are we going to have roughing? We are. This will be down to the 15, but Tulsa commits the unpardonable sin of roughing David Davis. It was Todd Hayes who ran into him. There is no excuse.
No way. You avoid the kicker. If you don't block it, you can see Dave Rader with those hands on the hips. Boy, he's upset. If you don't block it, you avoid him. You step to the side. He just runs in and drops him over, tries to hold him up.
Maybe.
Well, they've had turnovers on their last three possessions. And doesn't look like they're going to get this possession.
Well, those are plays that will kill you. If you're a coach, you can't coach your way out of those type of plays. Those are just mental errors.
Not sure what the discussion's about here. The kick came on fourth and five. And
I only saw one flag on the play, Dave.
We will have to decide now if you're Tommy Taylor if it's an automatic first down. And he says no. On the measurements, they would still need a fraction of the yard. It was listed as fourth and five, but that could mean, you know, fourth and 5.9.
Exactly.
And apparently it did.
That's exactly what the call was when they went over to the sideline to see if it was fourth down and exactly five or whether it was short of it. The flagpole, the fourth down marker is sitting to what looks to me to be just a touch over 5 yards for a first down.
That ball was downed on the Tulsa 13. And this snap will come from the Aggie 49. They will go for it.
I'm not believing this. I think he's going to try to draw him off sides. I can't believe this.
And now they'll kick it.
Now they'll kick it is right. I couldn't believe they were going to go for it on fourth and one. I thought they'd come out and just try to draw them off sides, which is what they tried to do. They almost got someone to flinch, though. Let's see if we can take a look at that. See if you see one of the defensive linemen flinch. Look at the bottom of the screen. Watch him flinch. See, up. Boy, another 4 or 5 inches. You snap that ball, you got a first down. But interesting, the decision to re-kick. They had the ball inside the 13-yard line, I think, Dave.
Right at the 13. Tulsa sets up the return here. And what a drop by David Davis at the 4-yard line.
Boy, makes it a great coaching decision.
52-yarder. That is perfection. And after the way this day began for him, that's got to feel great.
Boy, that's when you turn around and you say, what a great coaching decision. I decided 9 yards better.
Would have been the 13 instead. It's the 4. Tulsa, 96 yards away. They have 3 minutes and 45 seconds and one timeout to work with. Trailing by 5. Well, Marlo Fair's not in the game. It's Crowder wide left. And Ruben Leifert gets it. Great grab at the 17.
Well, that was an outstanding grab by Thompson.
That's his first of the day. He's their second leading receiver. They'd shut him out until this 12-yarder.
It's just a quick in, and look, he's falling down and makes that catch.
Not much speed, but enough. 4.740 for Thompson. He and Penn right, Crowder left. You lead a setback. Protection is outstanding. Thompson again. And had he not slipped and allowed Atkinson to hit him, that might have gone for big yardage.
Well, you know, there was another player here a few years ago that they said didn't have any speed either, a fellow named Steve Largent. But he went on to NFL stardom, but a nice catch in the seam. Like you said, if he hadn't slipped, he might have picked up another 10, 15 yards.
You know, our halftime guest used to have that same description of his abilities.
As yes.
All 70s receiver, Drew Pearson. They just produce him here on an assembly line. Under 3 minutes. Atkinson looping on the rush, caught by Penn. He's going to go.
For a score. The short crossing patterns are what are doing in A&M today. Again, not a long pass, just leads him perfectly. When he catches the ball, he's in between the front line and second line of coverage, and he's off to the races.
Bates and Marlon Haynes, the safeties, running into one another.
The Coriat might have gone the wrong way here. That may have been his drop into that zone.
So, if you're Tulsa, you're now saying to yourself, we scored too soon. Because still 2:47 to play.
What a big series for A&M. That's probably the understatement of the year. There's Coriot. Of course, a disappointment. I think he must have a groin pull, too. I saw the wrap on his groin, so that may be a big factor with his coverage on that last one.
High kick is extremely short from the 22. Tulsa team, an 18-point underdog, and they found themselves down by 18 at halftime. Four of their five scoring drives today under 1 minute. The big plays in the third quarter set the tone. 19 unanswered points in less than 2.5 minutes. And Rubley, with 2:03 in counting, has them looking for more. Healy again gets wide. Then Atkinson and Crooms close on him. And it'll be 3rd and 1. Since you asked, the last time to pull it back, rush for over 200 yards, there's a guy named Dickerson.
I think I remember him. Eric Dickerson.
That was the year SMU finished number 2 in the country. Mark Matheson, the wishbone quarterback who has thrown a touchdown pass today in for Rubley. They call it 2 needed. On 3rd down, here's the wishbone. And the leap by Hewley, 1st and goal.
Do is hold Tulsa to a field goal. If they're able to hold them to a field goal, then they can drive back and score to win this football game. If they let them go in by a score.
Boy, the Tulsa assistant coach just ran past us, and they sounded like a group of high school kids. They're excited.
I don't think they can stop the clock. They only have one timeout left. 39 seconds. They can't stop the clock.
We've got 30 seconds remaining. And one of the bigger upsets you're going to see in college football this year.
They're just watching that clock drive down. 14, 13, 12, 11. They only have one timeout left.
We are told the Aggies have a timeout. That must be an error. It's over. Down 18 at half, Tulsa pulls it out.
When sports scream,